Gospel according to Matthew, the 5th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus said, "You are the salt of the earth. But if salt has lost its taste, how can its saltiness be restored? It is no longer good for anything, but it is thrown out and trampled underfoot. You are the light of the world. A city set on a hill cannot be hid. No one, after lighting a lamp, puts it under a bushel basket, but on the lampstand, and it gives light to all in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others, so they may see your good works and give glory to your Father in heaven. Do not think that I have come to abolish the law or the prophets. I have come not to abolish, but to fulfill. For truly I tell you, until heaven and earth pass away, not one letter, not one stroke of a letter will pass from the law until all is accomplished. Therefore, whoever breaks one of the least of these commandments and teaches others to do the same will be called least in the kingdom of heaven. But whoever does them and teaches them will be called great in the kingdom of heaven. For I tell you, unless your righteousness exceeds that of the scribes and Pharisees, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
And please be seated. Grace and peace to you in the name of Jesus, the light of the world. Amen. Well, these days, it seems that whether you are looking at the news or out the window, it looks pretty dark. In these deep, dark days of winter, we are making our way through the season of Epiphany, a season that the church calls the season of light. It was weeks ago now, long before this preacher had looked ahead to see what the gospel text was for this particular Sunday, that we made the decision to dedicate today United's new star on February the 9th. Now, it seems to me more than a coincidence that this day, the day chosen to dedicate United's new Be the Light star, is also the day that Jesus shows up in our gospel readings saying, "You are the light of the world." Today's gospel reading is a continuation of Jesus' Sermon on the Mount. Last week, we listened as Jesus blessed our world, and he startled us by turning our expectations upside down, calling blessed the very people we might least expect to hear Jesus say are blessed. And today, again, Jesus begins with words of blessing. "You are the salt of the earth. You are the light of the world." Now, did you notice that Jesus didn't then go on to give his disciples some instructions on how they might better be light or salt? He doesn't tell them that if they just try really hard, they could become salt and light. Rather, Jesus tells them this is who they are. These words of Jesus are words of promise. They're words of pronouncement. And then Jesus commissions, he charges, he tells his listeners to go out and be the people that they're called to be. Go out and be salt in the world. Go out and be light in the world. One of our traditions is whenever we have a baptism, we light a candle and then we give it to the newly baptized, still wet with the baptismal waters. And we speak to them these words of Jesus from our gospel reading for today. "Let your light so shine before others that they see your good works and give glory to your Father in heaven." In other words, as people who have received the light and love of God poured out on us in Jesus, we're called not to just keep that all to ourselves, but we're called to share it in the world for the sake of the world. We're called to share it joyfully and generously. Jesus is speaking to us here about a life that is lived in a way that makes a difference for the world, for the sake of others. That's the nature of both salt and light. Neither salt nor light exists for themselves. They can only fulfill their purpose when they're used. used when they're poured out. When Jesus uses these words, salt and light, for this blessing, these words already meant something to him. Both light and salt are central images for the people of Israel in their scriptures. These are Jesus' own people. And both the law and the prophets of the Jewish people called for a life that flowed from God's own vision, God's own desire for our world. But I'm afraid that sometimes we get that wrong and we think that it's all about us. We fall into thinking that being a Christian, being one of Jesus' people in the world, is about doing things the right way or making sure that everybody else is doing what's right according to our standards. We want people to have good and right theology. Don't we teach every Lutheran, you are saved by grace through faith? And sometimes around Christmas, we hear people taking a stand as if the most important thing we could do as Christians is insist that everybody say Merry Christmas instead of Happy Holidays. It's about us and what we think is right. We reduce being salt and light to simply insisting on the right thing and the right thing for us. But being salt and light has always been for God's people, being used for God's purposes in this world. It's being poured out for the sake of others. In the reading for today from Isaiah, the prophet makes it clear what it means to live God's purposes in this world. Isaiah speaks here to people who are so proud of their religion, their festivals, their piety. But God addresses them and says, "What is the fast that I choose? Is it not to share your bread with the hungry and bring the homeless poor into your house? When you see the naked, to cover them, then your light shall break forth like the dawn." In today's gospel reading, Jesus sits down on a mountain and he looks into the faces of his followers and he says to them, "You are the light of the world. You are the salt of the earth." And when I listen to those words of Jesus, it makes me tremble just a bit because I realize those aren't just Jesus' words for people long ago and far away. Jesus is looking at me. He's looking at you. He's speaking those words to us today. And I don't know about you, but I don't always feel worthy or up to the task. I'm just an ordinary person who struggles and fails and tries to get back up again. Honestly, I feel like I'm a mess more often than I feel like I've got it all together. How could I possibly be the light of the world? And yet Jesus says that this is who I am, who you are, not by our own merit, but because this is who God has created and named us to be. Consider Jesus' first audience for these words. There were no obvious world changers gathered around Jesus that day. It's a crowd of ordinary people, probably some disappointed people, definitely some desperate people, people who've been told that they don't count for much. And these are always the people that Jesus chooses and blesses and sends. In Jesus, because of Jesus, our very ordinary, messy, imperfect lives are able to make a difference as we allow our lives to shine with the light of God. So to be salt, to be light, we don't have to be educated or important or wealthy or respectable. We just need to let God be at work in us and through us. Being salt and light is being compassionate people. It is being the lovers, the helpers, the givers, the healers. It is being those who practice kindness, those who move through this world with open hands and open hearts. It is practicing justice by standing with and for the least of this world. All of that matters. It matters to God, and it matters to others, even though we may never see or know the difference that we make. This week, I visited Joan and Jim Evenson. Once regular attenders and participants at United Lutheran, they're now mostly homebound. But it was fun to visit with them, to reconnect, and they made me laugh with their funny stories and their joyful spirits. And as I was preparing to leave, Joan asked what else I was up to that day. And I told her that next, a high school student that we both knew was going to stop by the office and say hello. "Oh," she said, "I remember him. He used to sit behind us, right behind us with his grandma every Sunday. And you know, I liked that kid so much." This young man, this high school student, his mother died when he was just 9 years old. And I told Joan that his grandmother had now passed away also. And she said, "You know what? I want to give him something. I'm going to give him something." And with that, she reached behind her chair and she pulled out her purse and she opened up her wallet and she took out a bill and then she stuck it into an envelope. And although she can barely see now, she wrote a note of blessing, all while Jim guided her hand. And then handing it to me, she said, "Now I want you to give this to him. Make sure you give it to him." And I did. You see, Joan simply saw a blessing that she could give. And she used what she had right in front of her to do it. I wish you all could have seen the surprise and the delight on this young man's face when he read Joan's note. He didn't even open up the envelope yet. "You are salt. You are light." 19 months ago, I traveled with Peter and our children, Matthew and Sarah, to Fargo. We were making that journey just 3 days after our daughter Rachel died. We were on our way to her home in Fargo to pick out clothes for her burial. It was an impossible task. We walked into her townhouse, everything just as she had left it on her way to take a vacation at the lake with us, her family. Rachel had moved into that townhouse just 10 months prior, and that move had taken place at a really busy time for her. It was the very same week that dear friends from England had come to visit her, and the very next week she traveled to take her part in a friend's wedding. And then from there, it was on to the nonstop flow of the school and church year for a youth director. Although everything was quite neatly in its place, she hadn't gotten around to hanging any pictures on the wall. But there was one exception, a small canvas hanging that read simply, "Be the light." Matthew saw it first and he touched it. And we all gathered around it. And as we looked at it, stumbling through the darkness of grief, looking for a way, a reason to keep on living, there it was, it seemed. We received it as a sign from God and a gift from Rachel. We knew that our beloved Rachel had lived her all too brief life shining with the light that God had gifted her to share for us, for her friends, for the kids she worked with at church. We knew that the love that God had poured out on her in baptism embraced her in death and would not let her go. And we knew that God was holding us as well and giving us a way to somehow live, to be light, to be salt, working for God's purposes, as long as we have breath. My friends in Christ, you are salt. You are light. This is who God has created and called you to be. Jesus said, "Let your light so shine before others that they see your good works and give glory to God in heaven." The world needs us to be who God has created us to be. And so as we dedicate this star today, may it shine for us. And as it does, reminds us of Jesus, the light of the world. And may its light also remind us of all those whose light has shined for us as a witness to the light and love of God in this world. And may we also see in its light Jesus' call, Jesus' commission for us to be the light for the sake of this world God so loves. Amen.